Stewart, who is the Chief Financial Officer for Marks & Spencer's, onto the stage to say a few words.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm conscious this isn't quite the summer of English weather that you might have been expecting, so I'll try and keep it short here. As Marks & Spencer's, I'm delighted to be the first operator here and alongside Simon Moore and DP Ports, because we are going to be the first logistics tenant at this largest distribution park in Europe. The Prime Minister today clearly sat out his stall on the UK's need to succeed in the global race. And M&S, we are going through a transformation, turning Marks & Spencer's from a traditional British retailer into an international multi-channel retailer. You've also heard today about supply chain and how important the supply chain is. And our colleagues and friends at DP World certainly understand that. We're busy transforming our supply chain, and this marks a key and vital step. This new distribution centre will service 50% of our stores in the UK. It'll reduce lead times such that goods arriving as imports will move from here to our stores within 3 days. Currently, it takes about 2 weeks to do that through our current distribution network. It's not only about imports, though, and serving UK customers. It's also a key export port for us. So this port will export into the European and international markets, serving not only clothing, but also furniture and ambient food. As Marks & Spencer's, we're committed to environmental and social factors as well. And so, like our Castle Donington warehouse, which we opened in the East Midlands recently, this will again incorporate our Plan A credentials and will be the leading environmentally friendly installation as well. And as we heard earlier today, we are committed to employing disadvantaged and disabled people as well. So of the 700 jobs that we'll be creating here on a full-time basis, we'll be aiming to have around a third of those through our Marks & Start program. During the construction phase, we'll also be employing thousands of people. And when we start turning the soil here next year, it'll be a couple of years until in 2016, we'll be opening our new distribution center. So we believe the investment we are making today is in what will be a leading, if not the leading, port in the UK. We're delighted to be the first tenant, and we look forward to working with DP Ports as this incredible project comes to fruition. Thank you very much indeed.
Alan, thank you very much. I'd also like to give my thanks to Marks & Spencer's, who have taken a massive leadership position here at London Gateway. We've been delivering this project from vision, from the drawing board, to reality over a number of years, often in times when there's been a lot of economic uncertainty as well. And we're really glad that Marks & Spencer's has the right levels of trust and confidence in us as DP World, in us as a management team at London Gateway, but also in the proposition that London Gateway is as well. So thank you very, very much. I'd like to invite the Minister for Business, Michael Fallon, onto the stage now.
Excuse me, can you get down? Well, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we've had a surfeit of speeches this morning, and I don't want to repeat what has already been said, except, of course, to congratulate DP World on this milestone, and, of course, to congratulate Marks & Spencer's for leading off in their tenancy. I think I recall their slogan, not just any investment, but an M&S investment. And very welcome for that. I'd like to salute this particular achievement for three reasons. First, its sheer size. Marks & Spencer's adding some 700 jobs here, but in total, when this port is fully operational, some 12,000 jobs. Let me put that in perspective. The biggest employer further up the river is Four Dagenham. This is four Dagenhams. Four Dagenhams put together. A huge new investment in this part of the river. Secondly, it is an investment not simply in financial or in physical terms, but an investment in human capital. As you've heard, the investment here in the skills of the local people and the opportunities that will be provided for local people, both by DP World and, as you've just heard, by Marks and Spencer, in upgrading the opportunities available for youngsters in this particular area, is enormously important to us. And thirdly, it is an investment not simply in London, but it is something that is good for the whole of the British economy. As you heard earlier, a boost to innovation, a strengthening of our supply chains, and support for hundreds of thousands of other businesses right across our economy. This is a very important day, not simply for the Thames, not simply for DP World and Marks and Spencer, but for the British economy as a whole. And I'd like to reassure both Marks and Spencer and DP World that the British government stands alongside them in their ambition. They want to grow. This port shows that growth. Marks and Spencer, being the first tenant here, shows the opportunity that they see here, and our government will be alongside them as they seek to grow that initial investment. We speak of Britain of being open for business. This is a great opening for Britain. Thank you.
Okay,
this what's happening today, what does it mean to the people of Thurrock?
Well, after 13 years of planning this development, it means some certainty. It means that jobs are arriving. We've heard 700 jobs Marks and Spencer's are creating here on this site by 2016. We also know the first ship bringing goods into the new port will happen sometime in the next 6 months. So all of that's good news, but we need a couple of things. We need to do all we can to make sure that these jobs do go wherever possible to local people. And the second thing I have to say is that Marks and Spencer's don't have a great reputation when it comes to trade union recognition and representation. So one of the things I'll be trying to do very quickly is to meet with people from Marks and Spencer's just to challenge them on that and see if we can get a better deal for people who will be working here.
Because yourself and Graham Farrant talk about a decade of delivery here. Do you have a foot in the door? Do you have an open line of communication down here?
Pretty much. You know, we didn't know in advance what today's announcement was going to be. We all knew that Marks and Spencer's were one of a number of organisations that DP World were talking to. We didn't actually know that was going to be the announcement that was made today. However, as I say, 13 years on, to actually see jobs, real jobs, being created has to be good news. And I also pay tribute to all those people who have kept with it for that decade and a bit. I go back right to the very beginning of this, when it was P&O who were looking to create a port here. When that seemed to be falling down and collapsing, it was DP World who came in, picked up the baton, and as we've said, through some really hard economic times, have stayed with this. I also know that for local people, we've got to make sure that we get the transport infrastructure right to make sure that the impact on the local community is as little as possible. We've got to minimise that, which means that we've got to get the extra lane onto the A13. We've got to get the M25 A13 junction right. The Prime Minister mentioned that today. What he failed to mention was that the government have so far bringing forward woefully little funds to actually make sure that we get a comprehensive job done there. And then we've got to get free flow tolling brought into the Dartford crossing as quickly as possible. You know, frankly, we're looking at the end of next year. I say that we need to do everything we can to bring that forward and get that in place now. And also we have this unnecessary distraction of looking to put a third river crossing somewhere in Thurrock. That is unnecessary and just detracts from the main
problem. A lot of discussions out with Thurrock about the Dartford crossing is, or the lower Dartford crossing, there's no actual reference to Thurrock, as if this is Essex or somewhere on the estuary or a point on a map. Does that concern you?
Yeah, of course that concerns me. And for too long, we've had a situation where Kent County Council and Essex County Council, two of the largest local authorities in the country, have frankly been able to ignore us and to put lines on maps without us having any say-so. that situation has changed now. You know, we are very clearly talking with Essex, talking with Kent, talking to government, and making sure that our voice is heard.
Thank you, John.